I'm back. Hi, I'm back. For those of you who don't know, and the new viewers out there, I've been hiking the Appalachian Trail. It's been incredibly long, but also character building, and it's been difficult the whole way. But here I am, and I've returned. I went close to half the total distance, and then I realized that there really wasn't any point to keep going, because I was doing it for self-improvement, and I felt that returning back to the internet and showers and making videos for you guys would be much more good to me, and so I have returned. And also, this is my first face reveal video. That doesn't really matter much to me, and I choose not to overhype it and make it all the whole clickbait thing, but I'm sure it'll matter to many of you. For those of you who guessed that I was a young, white, North American, nerdly male, congratulations. For those of you who had not, I give you the award of being unperceptive. Gather round, for a tale of atrocity and terror, of oppression and blood. We've all heard of the Atlantic slave trade, a truly massive movement moving millions of people across the Atlantic Ocean from the west coast of Africa to the cash crop fields of the New World. Its presence is felt even today, as the 12 million Africans brought in the migration created majority black nations in the New World, and even the nations that aren't majority black oftentimes have large African minorities. And so it really begs the question, how much did the Atlantic slave trade affect the world in which we currently live today? And what would a world in which it never occurred look like? What would borders, culture, politics, war, and everything else be like in this new, changed world? That is the question of this alternate history. Unlike many other alternate histories, like what if the South won the Civil War, or what if the Nazis won World War II, there's no big battle or big event that you can point to say that that is the point where, if things had gone differently, the Atlantic slave trade would have never happened. However, there definitely were cruxes in history where, if things had gone differently, that the Atlantic slave trade would never have happened. And there definitely were people who, if they did the right thing, the slave trade would never have occurred. This is because Europe in this era really did not have slavery. Christianity and the Catholic Church did not condone the practice, and so from the end of the Roman Empire until the 11th century, it had been phased out, and actually William the Conqueror, the Norman conqueror of England, at the Battle of Hastings in 1066 and all that, was actually a huge enemy of the slave trade and stamped it out in England. And most people during the Middle Ages were tenant farmers or serfs, and today we tend to confuse the two terms, but actually there's a world of difference. Being a serf means around 10% or more of your crop goes to your lord, and your lord decides whether or not you can marry outside of his estate or leave his estate, and you have to spend a certain allotted amount of days working for your lord. Meanwhile, being a slave means every aspect of you, whether physical, mental, sexual, or economic, is owned by your lord or master, and that you have about the same amount of legal rights as a horse or a pack mule. And if you told a Christian European around the year 1450 that the future of a European Western society would be slavery, they'd likely be shocked. So what allowed slavery to develop in the New World? A couple things. Firstly, the lack of population in settler societies can result in two separate effects, the first of which is that they can be freer. In some settler societies, the lack of population density and established government and traditions allows the individual to be much freer than they would be back in their home culture. And this happened in America with the cowboys, the Paulistas in Brazil, the Russian Cossacks, and even the Icelandic Vikings back in the Middle Ages. However, this creates issues if you want to maintain the same level of government, sophistication, culture, capital that you would have in your home country, because all of these free societies collapse into near barbarism when they're starting because they just don't have the resources for that. Well, if you want to be able to do that, then you have to resort to slavery. And this is especially appealing if you're a feudal lord or an aristocrat where you want to maintain the same standard of living as the old country, and so you enslave people to deal with that. And we saw this throughout the entirety of the Americas with both African, Native, and even some European slaves. And we saw this in Russia with their massive serf system that survived into the 19th century, and some people even suspect it's the origin of the caste system in India. The way we could have prevented the Atlantic slave trade from developing would be that someone powerful in the 16th century would have had to have made the conscious moral stance that the enslavement of Africans and slavery in general in the New World was morally wrong. And since the founding nations of the Atlantic slave trade were Spain and to a lesser extent Portugal, both Catholic nations, it would make sense that if the Pope could have made a conscious moral stance about it, that something could have been done. So just imagine in the 16th century that there had been a pope who had made it his life's work to prevent the Atlantic slave trade from developing, and he had issued edicts and bulls saying that slavery in the New World was wrong. An interesting example to look at would be the enslavement of natives in the New World. The Spanish, when they first arrived, enslaved massive numbers of the indigenous population for their own purposes. However, a combination of the papacy and the Spanish crown had lowered the status from slaves to serfs. And so by the time of independence, a full-blood indigenous person actually had far more rights than a mixed-race person. And so we can imagine something similar, which the combination of the papacy and the crowns of Iberia could have prevented African slavery from growing out of a conscious moral decision. And with the Catholic nations in line, the Protestant nations wouldn't want the Catholic nations to appear morally superior, and so the nations like Britain and Holland would not have done slavery either, as it wouldn't be part of what was morally acceptable in that society. Many of you are going to argue that the Atlantic slave trade was necessary because of the goods produced. I mean, how would you live without sugar, tobacco, and coffee? All things you're addicted to. However, the real tragedy of the Atlantic slave trade was that it produced things no one needed, luxuries. People in the Middle Ages lived without all of those things and cotton, which I'm hoping you're not freakishly addicted to somehow, perfectly happily, and never even considered all those products. All of these things we think we need because we're so used to them because slaves made them. I like to cook a lot, and I do a fair amount of medieval cooking and the cooking of medieval recipes. And it's really interesting how different their philosophy of cooking is from ours, because they didn't have any of the substances that I mentioned before. And so the only real way to make food more interesting in northern medieval Europe was to add more fat, and spice if you were really wealthy, so with small amounts of sugar. For example, one pie I made had beef, duck, egg, butter, and gravy all mixed together. Now that's a lot of juicy goodness. Western cuisine moved from an emphasis on mixing all sorts of tastes together, the pillar most world cuisines are built upon, to a concentration of powerful tastes, like sweetness, savory, salty, etc. This is why Chinese cuisine has sweet and sour chicken, what you would never see that in the West today. That medieval pie I was talking about also had spices and dried fruits to balance out the fats and meats involved, which is similar to what Chinese cooking philosophy is. This was allowed to happen in the West's change towards more direct tastes because Europe had slave labor that allowed the production of large amounts of flavors like sugar and caffeine. This is why so few non-European nations have strong dessert cultures. This emphasis on concentration of flavor in turn resulted in the production of more of these flavors. Thus, in a roundabout way, a world that forbade the Atlantic slave trade would not miss the results and would probably think that our cuisine was made in bad taste and overly vulgar. In this timeline, the Western societies would still have sugar and coffee and chocolate because everyone who can get those eats them to a certain extent. However, the production would be smaller because the demands would be smaller. That would also mean that the plantations involved would be smaller, rarer, and more unstable. The workers involved would likely be a combination of European and indigenous, with a minuscule number of African indentured servant labor toiling slowly in the fields to produce minuscule amounts of each of these substances. If you want to make some of these cash crops, it's absolutely brutal. And If you want to grow crops like sugar and coffee, vast parts of your workforce will die if you try to get them to work quickly due to the heat and the disease involved. And so, without cheap, expendable African labor, that would not happen. This timeline is really hard to make chronologically. And so instead, I'll focus on different regions of the world individually and then bring it all together for the finale of how the entire world would be different. The region affected most by the Atlantic slave trade was the Caribbean, in which most of the nations are majority black. Barbados and Jamaica are both 92% black, and Haiti is 95%. This is mainly because this region is perfect for growing sugar. Sugar, as mentioned before, is a very labor-intensive and often lethal crop that made massive amounts of money, so there was both the demand and the money to have huge numbers of slaves. The native peoples of the Caribbean were all wiped out in the first few decades of the 16th century, meaning that in this timeline the Caribbean would probably become majority white. This was actually developing in our timeline. In Barbados, the English had a strong tobacco-growing middle class. Meanwhile, both the Bahamas and Jamaica were bases for raiding the Spanish galleons. The area that became Haiti were inhabited by Spanish hunters called buccaneers, who hunted the feral pigs in the area and sold them to the Spanish authorities and galleons passing by. They invented barbecue, with their word for the style of cured meats they cooked being boucan, or the kind of crate they used to cook their meats. The Spanish tried to get rid of them by killing their pigs and by cutting down the forest. This just resulted in the buccaneers, as they came to call themselves, turn to the sea and become pirates. Strangely, they even developed homosexual unions called the Brothers of the Coast due to the lack of women. I could talk all day about pirates, and I would love to have you guys recommend pirate alternate histories, but sadly, this video is not about piracy, and so this pirate accent will end. The Spanish referred to the Caribbean as the Useless Islands because it only really existed for the Spanish as a stopping point to get to their more important colonies like Mexico and Peru, and Havana was their big center for resupply on their big galleon routes across the Atlantic. And the whole Spanish strategy of enslave the native population and live like lords back home failed in the Caribbean, and so the entire native population was wiped out, and the region was really lightly settled until black slaves were brought in to replace the indigenous population. The white population in the Caribbean would grow, although not radically. The land just simply isn't very good if you're trying to grow anything except sugar. And it's kind of similar to the issues that were faced in our timeline by the British colonies of New Zealand, South Africa, and Australia, in each of which the land quality is worse than North America, so they always had to play second fiddle for immigrants and thus always received less white immigration than North America. This would happen to the Caribbean in our timeline with the British. For the French, meanwhile, their only other options to export their white population would be the swamps of Louisiana and the frozen wastes of Canada. So the French colonies in the Caribbean would receive a larger percentage of their French immigration, but at the same time, the French exported far fewer people than the British, and so it would all balance out in the end. Except Haiti would have a fairly high population density as underpopulated French colonies go. Meanwhile, the Spanish exported very few people after the early 16th century to their colonies, mostly because the local social hierarchies didn't want more white Spaniards to come in and disturb the position the previous white Spanish Creole population, as they called themselves, had. Meanwhile, Spain was losing population very quickly due to a combination of plagues and fighting everyone in Europe at once in wars, and so didn't really have much excess population to send to the colonies, so the Spanish colonies in the Caribbean would remain very lightly populated. The light population density and bad soil would result in most of the Caribbean's economy being based around herding and small-scale agriculture. This is like New Zealand, the South African Cape, and Australia in our timeline, all of which were stuck in the same predicament. The lack of good soil prevented there from being enough income to create an industrial economy, which prevented there from being more immigration, which keeps everyone on square one for much longer. In general, New Zealand on a smaller scale is a pretty good model for how these tropical islands would develop. And don't get me wrong, New Zealand is a really great country, but it's not exactly a historically important or fabulously wealthy society. In our timeline, the Americas were pretty disease-free before Columbus. There are a few possible exceptions, but when the Europeans arrived, they had a massive disease advantage over the native population. And that's most of the reason for why the European conquest succeeded. However, on the other hand, it meant that the American tropical civilizations were able to thrive beautifully, while they oftentimes hit disease issues inside the Old World. Well, meanwhile, Africa is one of the most diseased areas on the planet. It was practically impossible for non-African explorers to get more than a few miles past the coast into the interior without dying of disease before 100 years ago when modern medicine came in. And in our timeline, the import of African slaves into the New World and their diseases meant that parts of the American tropics became nearly as deadly as the African tropics. And so this involved the import of more African slaves to deal with the diseases that only they had the immunities against. And so this resulted in a cascading effect and a major population shift inside the American tropics. In this timeline, it would be much healthier for Europeans and the indigenous population inside the American tropics, and this shift would have happened significantly later or never happened at all. The colony that imported the sheer highest number of slaves was Portuguese Brazil, and because of that, Brazil has become a multiracial society in which the descendants of the slaves and the Europeans mixed to become the majority group. And Brazil's economy in the colonial era was entirely dependent upon slavery, whether that was in the giant coffee or sugar plantations or in the enormous diamond and gold mines. And our timeline's Brazil has become dependent on cheap labor for most of its history due to that very reason, and a colonial Brazil without slavery is almost impossible to imagine. Slavery is very detrimental to stable free societies. This is because of the enormous concentration of labor and capital means that it puts small businesses and workers out of the markets. This means that even among the free population, there's far less social mobility and equality. This lack of opportunities means that there's actually less immigration as well, which means the population grows more slowly. Slave societies almost never have a strong emphasis on education, because what they aspire to is a docile, uneducated, cheap labor source. And so that also adds up as well, and most of the money is poured back into the slave system, and so there's less extra income for industrialization and commercialization. This process occurred in the American South, South Africa, Brazil, and Latin America as a whole. And a free Brazil in this timeline would have a much more dynamic economy. Without African diseases, it would also be healthier for European farmers than it would be in our timeline. And so the massive land and resources of Brazil would be a huge beacon for European immigrants. It's kind of become a meme on this channel of how consistently disappointed I am in Brazil. And the really sad thing is how many of my Brazilian fans actually agree. But I genuinely think that without slavery, Brazil would be able to reach its full potential. The Brazil of this timeline would be a superpower. In this world, many small farmers would settle the fertile regions of Brazil, spending their income on improving their equipment and thus raising their economies and societies. This would in turn drag up the economy of the whole region. In the same way, Mexico and Central America has a lot of trade with America and thus gains a lot of income that way, both through legal and illegal trade, nations like Argentina, Bolivia, and the like would receive large amounts of exchange with the Brazilian economy and thus influence. The first thing you need to understand about Anglo-North American slavery is that it was caused by pre-existing events rather than being a cause in of itself. Most of the American lowland South was settled by the second sons of English nobility, who wanted to be able to have Old World-style estates with serfs just like back home. However, this resulted in issues in America in which much of the indigenous population had already been wiped out by European diseases. And at the same time, the European immigrants really were not keen about becoming a serf just like back home because they could just get their own land further west. This meant to support the pre-existing culture, black slaves were imported in from Africa. Without this cheap labor, the lowland southern culture we saw in our timeline would simply collapse. This would mean that America's aristocratic side, including figures such as George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, would simply not exist. The South would mainly be small farmers raising crops like tobacco, hogs, and corn. The South's soil actually isn't very good compared to that of the Midwest, and so we might see the agricultural style of Appalachia predominate across the whole South, with hogs combined with small fields and foraging, basically turning the American South into a giant Afghanistan for several hundred years. This would make the American South desperately poor. Without slavery, the American South, and especially the Lowland South, would be much poorer and more lightly settled. The climate is simply much less healthy for European Americans than it is in the North, and so there wouldn't be much incentive without the tropical cash crops to settle in the American Lowland South. And this would result in greatly weakening the South's power culturally and politically inside America. However, it would be great news for the native tribes. In our timeline, there were powerful tribes in the Southeast like the Cherokee, the Creek, the Seminole, and the Chickasaw, and these were part of what were called the Seven Civilized Tribes, which were able to adapt to European technology and custom with greater ease than the other native peoples, and they were only barely evicted from their land in our timeline. And so in this timeline, with less pressure and attention in the southern lands, they'd likely remain a large minority in the region with a large amount of political power and clout. Without the South being a large cultural, economic, and political force for much of America's history, the United States would be much more homogeneous and much more along the lines of Australia culturally, because the North would just be able to do whatever the hell it wanted. And at the same time, the United States would also likely be a much more left-wing and socialistic nation, with politics more like Canada in our world. The ex-slave states have been conservative on practically every issue imaginable, thus slowing down social change in every department. Also, almost all social programs in America become poisoned by some form of racial tension. Part of the reason social programs are so distrusted in America is they end up getting viewed as economic redistribution between ethnic groups that aren't exactly keen on each other. Race and class are inextricably linked in America, and this plays against people's natural tribalism. This is why all the nations with large welfare systems are fairly homogeneous. When people think their welfare payments are going to pay for their grandmother or their deadbeat cousin, they're much more accepted. The South, just like in our timeline, would become quite wealthy in recent years as air conditioning, modern medicine, cheap non-union wages, and a lack of regulation would mean that businesses would relocate to it from the overtaxed and overregulated northern states, just like in our timeline with the Sun Belt. The United States would likely be more anti-Catholic and anti-Jewish. In general, each society has to have some group that they dislike, and I'm sure lots of folks will say, my society doesn't, and we're completely tolerant, but in general, in that case, it's either the other party or foreigners. And for the United States, it's mainly been the blacks, who have on average been the most downtrodden group. And white Protestants could always remark about Jews and Catholics that at least they aren't black, and so the Jews and the Catholics got a better deal. But in this timeline, that likely would not be the case. And as a Canadian, I can tell you this process definitely did happen in Canada until recently. And so in this timeline, the Jews and Catholics would take longer to assimilate, and the United States would likely have prevented more Southern Europeans and Jews from migrating in at the end of the 19th and early 20th centuries. The U.S. would have annexed less of the Southwest from Mexico during the Mexican-American War in this timeline. This is because if you're doing northern-style cattle and milk and grain-style agriculture, this area is nigh useless. However, if you are having a southern-style cotton agriculture, it's remarkably useful. And so in this timeline, cities like Los Angeles, Las Vegas, and Phoenix would just be part of Mexico. As an American, I always assumed that the effects of the Atlantic slave trade were mostly in the New World. However, as I read African history, I realized that you can't take 12 million people out of a continent with 34 million in it and expect no changes to happen. The largest trend inside Africa caused by the Atlantic slave trade was the movement of people and power and wealth from the interior of Africa to the coasts. And this was caused because the Europeans put their forts on the African coast, and they subcontracted local coastal African tribes to go into the interior to get slaves for them. And so this resulted in the weakening of the previously powerful Sahel states of North Central Africa, and every high school history teacher's favorite Mali and Songhai empires, and resulted in their decline to the coast. The second major geopolitical effect of the Atlantic slave trade on Africa was the introduction of guns and gunpowder into the region. And This had the effect of producing a nasty series of wars, in that local regimes would start wars to get slaves, to trade into the Europeans to get gunpowder, and since their neighbors had guns, they needed to get more guns, so they'd start wars to get more slaves to keep up the competition. And this had the nasty effect of depopulating and devastating the whole region. And the nasty thing is it actually might have prevented this region from suffering too badly in the Mini Ice Age. And the Mini Ice Age was a period from around 1300 to 1800 in which the global climate was significantly cooler than today. And it was worse in the 17th century, and it was so bad, actually, that some historians think that a third of the whole world's population might have died off, due to basically every major country had a war and a nasty famine. But actually, West Africa didn't suffer that badly, because it was already so depopulated from all these wars dealing with the Atlantic slave trade. And normally this area suffers bad droughts, and they did, but the population density was low enough that there actually wasn't massive famine, and the worst thing that happened was there was a jihad of some folks in the grasslands trying to attack south into the wetter tropical forests. Part of what allowed the African slave trade was the introduction of New World crops like corn into West Africa, which increased the population density. This, combined with the Mini Ice Age, would mean that there would be many wars in this region, like there were in every other region of the world in the 17th century. The most common variation would likely be the raids and conquests of the Sahel grassland peoples south into the forests, and this would likely be masked as jihads against the pagan inhabitants of the forest. However, I don't think these wars would be as deadly and as detrimental as the Atlantic slave trade, because the aim of them would not be to destroy and depopulate whole regions of the area, and there would be less gunpowder because the Europeans would be trading less of this region because it wouldn't have a large commodity that the Europeans would trade guns for. I don't see why the European colonization of Africa that happened around the year 1900 would never have happened in this timeline. There's simply no way the Africans would have been able to bridge the technological gap that Europe had after industrialization and the invention of medicines that could deal with Africa's diseases. People like to claim that without the African slave trade, Europe never would have had its economic revolution and never would have risen to world predominance with events like the Industrial Revolution never occurring. This stands up to no scrutiny. As I said before, slave societies themselves are poorer than non-slave societies, but what does that say about their mother nations? The Muslims had a much larger and longer slave trade with Africa, and that certainly did not have the effects we saw inside Europe. Also, inside Europe, the nation most involved in the Atlantic slave trade was Portugal, and they were dirt poor until recently. Meanwhile, Belgium, Germany, and much of Scandinavia had practically no involvement in the Atlantic slave trade, but they're some of the wealthiest and most successful areas in the whole world. Meanwhile, inside the United Kingdom, Bristol was the largest town in the slave trade, but the areas that kickstarted the Industrial Revolution were towns in the North Midlands like Sheffield, Leeds, and Manchester, although I must admit that Glasgow and Liverpool started out as slave trading stations, and then later morphed into being industrial behemoths. In general, the belief that resources and success are correlated is just a fallacy. For example, nations like Nigeria and Iraq have a large amount of oil. Well, they're not doing very well. Well, meanwhile, Switzerland and Japan have practically nothing of value, but they're some of the wealthiest and most successful societies in the world. A general truth about societies and people in general is that if you give people wealth they didn't earn with their own hands or brain, they're going to waste it. And that's what happens here, where most of the revenue from the Atlantic slave trade was spent by the nouveau riche to gain luxuries to make themselves appear like the old nobility. And there was a small group, almost entirely British, who did invest their income in their local economies and helped the Industrial Revolution. But the only area that really did have an Industrial Revolution during the slave trade was a small area in the northwest of England. Well, most of history has had slavery. And that's part of the tragedy of the Atlantic slave trade, in that millions of people were tortured and enslaved so that we could get goods that we didn't need that made us unhealthier, and much of the income of it was just frittered away, and the societies it built were stunted and warped for hundreds of years afterwards. The main central fact that just screams into this world is that Brazil is a power on par with the United States. In our timeline, the United States has been the unquestioned hegemon of the Western Hemisphere, and this has allowed the United States to project power beyond that hemisphere, and it's why the United States is doing drone strikes in Sudan, sending money to the Poles, and has troops on the ground in Afghanistan. And that just wouldn't be the case in this timeline, where the Brazilians and the Americans would struggle over control of the Americas. The main conduit of American and Brazilian competition would be the Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean, which I've heard some geopolitical analysts refer to as America's Mediterranean, because it's the central region by which the whole of the Americas revolve around geographically and geopolitically. With America's main threat being below it, it would make sense that the United States would annex Cuba. In our world, a majority of white Cuban landowners during the Cuban-American War wanted the United States to annex Cuba, and in this timeline, with this demographic being the majority, this might have been the case. However, in this world with a more anti-Catholic America, that might not be the case, it might be different. However, the United States would still likely annex Cuba due to its geographic importance and make it a state. And since it would be lightly populated, the United States would likely fill it with Anglos and make it a less trashy version of Florida. The British white states of the Caribbean would likely form a federation, as British white colonies have a tendency to do, and they would work side and side with their cousins the Americans to gain control of the Caribbean, and they would likely seize Spanish Hispaniola and turn French Haiti into a docile ally. There's no way the United States would support a Brazilian-aligned regime in Mexico, or a regime of any threat in Mexico, and so the United States would always support a puppet regime in Mexico City. However, the Mexicans, to gain some autonomy, would likely have a grassroots movement supported by Brazil. Like much of Latin American politics, this would likely take on a class distinction, with the Mexican-Brazilian grassroots movement likely taking on a peasant flair to it, while meanwhile the Americans would support the status quo, which would be more stable than the aristocracy, that would fear that the peasants would take away their land grants. This would likely mean that there would be an American-supported regime in Mexico City, and always a guerrilla campaign that would have trouble being put down somewhere out in the provinces, that would be supported by the Brazilians. Okay, kids, are you prepared for my favorite game, aligning various areas of the world for World War I hundreds of years after my point of departure? And this time, it's South America! To start, Paraguay and Uruguay have probably already been cannibalized by Brazil by now. Meanwhile, Argentina's got a large grudge against Brazil, and having a giant superpower enemy to the north might instill some fiscal responsibility inside the Argentines, but I doubt it. Meanwhile, Chile has got a large grudge against Argentina, so they would side with the Brazilians. Because of this, Argentina would side with the United States. Peru and Bolivia, angry from the War of the Pacific, would side against Chile with the United States. Meanwhile, Colombia, angry that the Americans took land for their Panama Canal, would side with Brazil. In general, the war would enter a scheme in which many small countries around Brazil would side against Brazil to hem in Brazil's power and prevent it from gaining complete control over the continent. In World War I, the United States and Brazil would be on opposing sides. The United States would likely side with Britain, its mother country, and thus the Entente. Meanwhile, Brazil would likely side with the Central Powers. The stupid number of people of Italian descent in Brazil might result in the Italians staying with the Central Powers and not switching sides. And it's theoretically possible Portugal could also be a Central Power as well. And so, I leave you here with an epic war fought over the Guianas, Caribbean, and Central America between these two giant leviathans. Thank you for watching that video. If you enjoyed this content, please subscribe, stay tuned for future videos, comment, and like. And as always, thank you so much for watching and have a great day.